And as you know, as Muslims, we should always be striving to make dua the central part of our day.
Absolutely. And to introduce us more to some exciting duas and some spiritual lessons is Brother Haider Jezani. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
How are you this morning?
Alhamdulillah.
Good.
How's it with you?
Good, alhamdulillah. And always, I look forward, I kind of associating you with dua. So it's, yeah, a, it's a positive
shukr.
Connection.
Alhamdulillah. Shukr. So today's dua is actually a very deep, it's a bit of a longer one, but it involves a lot of forgiveness seeking. Basically from with this one, Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad Sadiq, from his father, who said, when the noble prophet had completed his morning prayers, he would continue to face the Qibla until the sunrise. Okay. At this time, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam Ali, would come forward and sit behind him, and everyone will come and gather up behind him, because they know after Jama'at that Rasulullah will be doing a few of the ad'iyya, and they obviously want to see the du'as from no man better than him. Mm-hmm. So they used to huddle up behind him, and he used to supplicate the du'as and stuff like that. There are many narrations that once that happens, and once the companions actually sit behind him, a lot of the hajat already maqdiyah before they even left the jami'. So it's a very beautiful dua. The words are quite simple. Mm. I mean, the meaning of it is just, Allah, I seek protection from you, from grief and sorrow, weakness and laziness, miserness and cowardness, turning away from the truth and idle talk of men, wasting time and negligence. So basically, is Allah, I ask you from anything negative to be pushed away from me. So I want you to protect my eyes and what they see, my ears and what they hear, my mouth and what it says, and my actions and what it does. So this dua is very beautiful. I mean, this one is very deep. You're asking for a lot, so you have to, inshallah, your intentions towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when reciting this has to, of course, it's clean, because when you actually come and recite something like this, you have to know the meanings of it. It's very important. There's no point of reciting it, not knowing what it means, because it's very, very deep.
Because obviously these are lessons, aren't they, to sort of give us an idea of what we ought not to be. So you're saying, okay, grief and sorrow is not in our hands, but we ask for protection to remain patient. Weakness and laziness is in our hands, and to be proactive.
More
and
motivated, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, motivated. Exactly. miserliness and cowardice, again, generosity, bravery is the positive of those, and turning away from the truth and idle talk of men, which is quite an interesting one, because I guess that's something that everyone is quite prone to do.
Of course.
And it's always being vigilant, isn't it, of yourself? Mm-hmm. So as you're saying, if we don't know the meaning, how are we going to make the changes within us?
Exactly.
To actually reflect what
it reminds me of a psychological prompt, because I think I've heard it said before that if we say, for example, we're in a freezing building and we ask Allah to keep us warm, we would at least need to close the window if there was no heat to take effect. So even though we're asking from Allah, we have a responsibility. Yes. So there are memory cues of how to be self-conscious, self-aware about our weaknesses or our inclinations towards laziness. So we're going to strive to not be that, and then Allah will give us the extra to make it, inshallah.
Yeah, of course. Definitely. I mean, being a human being is very difficult. there's a lot of things that's very difficult for you to control. For instance, being lazy. Sometimes you're actually lazing around and you're doing nothing at home, and you haven't realized until later on, you're like, oh, I'm really supposed to be doing this. Mm. Okay, another 5 minutes. That 5 minutes turns into 45 minutes without you realizing. So something sometimes a human being is still weak, cannot control many of their feelings. And, you know, even in terms of, you know, being bukhul, being tight, stingy, being not giving. Yeah. Mm-hmm. This doesn't mean financially, it doesn't mean physically, it doesn't mean anything that, you know, anything that's something in front of you, or you have in your hand, and you don't give away.
With your time, for example.
With your time, with your ibadah.
Absolutely.
With your akhlaq, with your patience,
yes.
With your thank giving. All these things come under the same tent.
It's fascinating. I think you know, the dua continues, and it's the vileness, the cruelty, destitution and poverty. And it's, when we look at these things like destitution and poverty, it's not just thinking about ourselves, is it? It's about the ummah, about saying that we are a part of a bigger, you know,
part of a body.
Yes. And you know, to help ourselves is to help others, and to help others is to help ourselves as well.
Of course.
And to really widen our own scopes, isn't it, to say that protect us from all of this and allow us to give the ability to even put that in our heart, because without Allah's mercy upon us, how could we even show these traits? They're His mercy. So do you want to continue with the, would you
like
to
I'll recite it and then okay. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الهم والحزن والعجز والكسل والبخل والجوب وضلع الدين وغلبة الرجال وبوار الأيم والغفلة والذلة والقصوى والعيلة والمسكنة. وأعوذ بك من نفس لا تشبع ومن قلب لا يخشى ومن عين لا تدمع ومن دعاء لا يسمع ومن صلاة لا تنفع. وأعوذ بك من امرأة تشيبني قبل أوان مشيبي. وأعوذ بك من ولد يكون علي ربا. وأعوذ بك من مال يكون علي عذابا. وأعوذ بك من صاحب خديعة إن رأى حسنة دفنها وإن رأى سيئة أفشاها. اللهم لا تجعلني فاجرا علي يدا ولا منة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. So as I said, this poem, this dua, is very poetic at the same time. So how I mean by that is a person, when he listens to this, what a poem has, what kind of reaction a poem should have on a person, is emotionally build up a story, and towards the end, it gives you the full outcome of the poem and
like the moral reason. Of the story.
Exactly, the moral of the story will come at the end. So this is what it does. It builds up at the beginning. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazn. Oh Allah, I see protection from hem, means grief and sorrow. And then it goes on, it goes on, it goes on, until at the end it says, until at the end, it gives you more details about what he means. So in life, oh Allah, I seek protection from a partner which will stress me out. Mm. Or I seek protection from a child which will turn around against me and be person in charge, or try to overcharge me, or overcome and you know, take over the family that I've brought up.
Timeless. This dua is like a timeless dua, because this is
literally
going on.
Yeah.
This is a, you know, in the society, not just the Muslims, but in the society at large, people have this problem where one spouse is a cause of the other spouse's issues.
Exactly.
Is it
exactly.
fitting it in the house between the man and the woman?
Yeah.
One person.
Man and woman as a son.
Yeah.
You know, son, when the man gets too old, he thinks, that's it, my dad's an old man, I'm going to come and take control.
Yeah.
And that's a disrespect towards the father.
These days it's only when they're old.
Yeah. Exactly. Happening. Exactly. It's happening all the time. Yeah. And it says, oh Allah, protect me from a daughter or a son who will open up all grief to my life, open up everything that's bad towards my life, and anything good they'll cover. So this is literally, as you said, it's reality. This is a reality check, basically, for you to actually sit down for a minute, actually think about your life and think about what's going on.
You don't become that spouse and you don't become the child that exactly. would become that to their parents.
You don't want to be the source of that discomfort.
No. Exactly, yeah.
Because we often think about being the victims in a situation. I don't want to be, you know, the parent that has a child, but we could be that child that could be the one that's oppressing our parents or overcoming them, and or we could be the spouse without saying, oh, I don't want my spouse to be like that. But how about, you know, the self-reflection comes into that, we ensure we're not doing that to others.
Empathy, the ability to feel what the other person is feeling.
And sometimes a mother doesn't show you, like you may have said something wrong, the mother will never show you. You know, how much have we brought grief towards our mothers? The next day they wake up, your breakfast is ready, everything's ready for you, your clothes are done up, everything is done like as if nothing has happened. But not knowing that you've actually said something you've heard to yesterday, because it's not something in your subconscious to be like, ah. You know, sometimes when you're young, you're reckless. You sometimes you do things
without
even... That was the word
I was thinking of, carelessness. Out of carelessness.
Exactly.
Yeah. Not carelessness. Intent to cause that harm, but just not thinking.
Exactly. Not thinking about what you're saying.
Yeah, yeah.
This is sometimes the smallest words can break a mother's heart. You know, and this is the type of heart that you would never want to break. Mm-hmm. You know, a father stronger emotionally. A lady is strong emotionally, but they have these very sensitive spots where it's about either your son or your daughter, the way they speak to you. But at the end of the day, your mother will say, forgive you. And the next day, as if nothing happened, your food is ready, everything's ready.
That's the mother's love,
exactly. So what this dua is pushing away your carelessness, making sure that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps you not to say something bad towards this person who cares so much for you. So seeking protection from what that atonement for me, from greed.
Mm-hmm.
The more you get, the more you want, right?
Mm.
So seeking protection from wealth, because, you know, once you start become successful, it's a natural thing. If your yaqeen isn't strong enough, if your insaniya is not sure, if your humanity self, it's not strong enough, you know, the wealth can take over your life and become
definitely,
a source of control
definitely,
to you.
Definitely.
And it's something that you'll start actually doing things to get to.
Yeah.
And, you know, pushing away the halal and haram,
yeah.
pushing away your family and friends, pushing away people you love. Because money right now, money is the poison of this world. What everyone is fighting for right now, and the whole world, every single problem comes out from what root? The money.
Is it the money, or is it the fact that we have greed within us? Because
the love of the money.
Yes.
It's not even physically the money, it's greed for power and wealth.
Yeah.
Greed to having things.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know, I was thinking of the earlier part of the dua when it talks about, you know, the self that never gets satisfied, and that comes in like a really deep spiritual disease, because it's like people who have physical food but they eat and they can't be satisfied by the food, and then likewise people have been given wealth but they're always in some kind of spiritual debt or something like this because they can't be happy. They're constantly chasing, and that's in the Muslim world and in the world in general. You see in the mainstream, people who have millions and they still die or commit suicide or they end up getting strung out on drugs. And you would think, wow, this man's worth 200 million, or this woman is worth how many million? Homes, cars, everything, and they're still unhappy. So that shows it can't just be the material.
Money doesn't bring you happiness, it brings you more problems in my eyes. But you have to be strong enough to take to bypass these problems. That's what I personally think.
Thank you so much. It's been an honour again to have you for reciting. That's all we have time for today. Next up, we have hijab and etiquette.